All right, I think we'll go ahead and get started since we have just an hour together with you today. So I just want to point out that we have a lot of participants from different countries. So in New York City, currently it is 12 o'clock, but for those of you joining from other places in the world, thank you for joining us at night or in the morning, whatever time it may be from where you're calling in from. So today we have a fantastic presentation by our educator, Shinsuke, who's a panelist here with us today. And this is the second session of four in our free Guggenheim webinar series titled Themes for Contemporary Art, which is generously sponsored by the Freeman Foundation. This online series is really meant to explore contemporary artists inspired by themes with global, local, and personal relevance, and highlights recent acquisitions by the Guggenheim, as well as recent on-site exhibitions. Today's program is led again by Shinsuke, who is an artist from Japan. Shinsuke currently lives and works in New York and has been a bilingual gallery educator at the Guggenheim for 10 years. Our theme for this afternoon is on the screen, objects and images in contemporary art, and we'll explore how artists challenge perceptions about the world around us by appropriating objects and images. So a few Zoom housekeeping tips before we go into the presentation. You'll notice for this webinar, chat as well as the Q&A feature has been enabled at the bottom of your screen. Again, if you want all of your comments to be read, please change the tool to all panelists and attendees in the chat box. If you have any slide specific questions or specific questions, you can put that in the Q&A, and we'll be reviewing the Q&A at the end of this program, and hopefully we'll have time to answer everyone's questions. Lastly, this webinar is being recorded, and we will be sharing the link to the recording the day after the program through email. So if you've registered, you should receive a link to the program and to see the recording. All right, I think that's it for me. I'm going to hand it over to Shinsuke to take it away.
Thank you, Quina, for the introduction. And hi, everyone. Hope everybody's well. My name is Shinsuke. So as Quina just introduced, we are going to discover how artists challenge perceptions about the world around us by appropriating objects and images. So also I'm planning to do a little activities with everyone, and I'm going to ask some questions and ask your response to put in the chat. But this is not a test, so please do not hesitate, and feel free to join the activities. And I'd like to start this webinar with a quotation by a Japanese-American artist and art educator, Ruth Asawa. She said, "An artist is an ordinary person who can take ordinary things and make them special." So as you see in this picture, so this is Asawa herself with her sculptures. So her practice as an artist is that she observed shapes in nature and created these beautiful hanging sculptures with just a wire. So the artists we are going to look at today are slightly different in styles, but I believe they share the very similar spirit. So let's start with the first artist. So the first artist I'd like to introduce is French artist Marcel Duchamp. And this piece is entitled Fountain, and it was originally made in 1917. So Duchamp was the sort of pioneer of the sort of using found object in Western art. So he called it ready-made. So instead of making paintings or sculptures, he basically selected an object which was the manufactured by the factory. So these are like a very sort of ordinary product. But by repositioning and also sometimes joining combining with other objects and the titling and assigning, he believed that he could turn the mundane object into art. So this his sort of intention of creating this piece was provoking the art world and provoking the public, provoking everybody's sort of a perception of art, by sort of presenting a ready-made object. And in this case, he selected the urinal, and which is normally hung on the sort of a, you know, placed on the wall, you know, vertically. But in this case, he repositioned in a sideways and placed on the pedestal, presented as a sculpture. Also, he used, you know, fake name Al Mutt, you know, signed on the edge of the urinal, and so that he was sort of disguising some other artist, you know, to present this to surprise the art world. And sometimes, you know, he has, you know, actually he often used pun in his artwork. So art historians and critics, you know, believes that the, you know, the name Al Mutt is some sort of pun. And also, that I love that the use of, you know, the urinal as you know, selection of the object that he chose for this piece. So the urinal maybe sort of connotes, you know, his sense of humor and the irony, you know, and also his rejection of the you know, conventional, you know, art in the Western world. So actually, I chose this piece for the first, you know, sort of slide, because I have a sort of personal connection to this, you know, artwork. So when I was a teenager, I was not really good at the academic art, you know, making drawings and paintings and sculptures. And I didn't like art much. But when I learned about, you know, this ready-made object by Marcel Duchamp, I thought, oh, I could do this too. And that's how I became an artist and is still making art with the found objects. So let's move to the next slide. So this is the picture taken during the exhibition by artist Lee Ufan, originally from Korea, and he moved to Japan when he was 20 years old. And he became one of the prominent artists in the art movement called Monoha in 1970s. So his focus was is the relationship between the objects. So he sort of prepared, you know, these two objects in the exhibit space. But the most important part of his work is the relation between this, you know, stone and this steel plate. So the title is relatum, a signal. So relatum is a philosophical term which means existence of the relationship between two or more objects or events or terms. And also, he specifically chose, you know, these materials, stone and steel, in his sculptural pieces. So the stone represents something, the steel plates. So steel plates represent the material which we built our society. And the stone, on the other hand, was formulated by nature over time. So that sort of connotes the sense of you know, the uncontrollability, you know, by human being. So these are natural form. So he sort of placed the natural form against the artificial object. And also by doing, you know, selecting this object, you know, he rejected the conventional the method of, you know, creating art, like, you know, oil paint on canvas or marble sculptures. So I'd like to do a quick activity with everyone here. So let's take a look at, you know, this piece for 30 seconds. And while we are looking at it, please think about, you know, how would you describe the relationship between this stone and the steel plate? And please type in chat with maybe one or two words and share with everyone. Like, Lee himself, you know, titled a signal, but we can perceive completely different way. And just in case, I'd like to mention that the one edge of the steel plate is bent and raised towards the stone. So let's take 30 seconds to do a quick activity. So please feel free to put your comment in chat. The comments are coming in. Thank you. Nature and inorganic, which will persist. They seem to be in conversation. Everyone is looking for their place in universe. a slight pull, tension. They seem a bit separated. Thank you so much for your comments. It is like, really interesting. I love this activity with everyone. So we are looking at the same artwork, but our response is completely different, and that sort of enrich the experience of sharing ideas and thoughts. So some people say there's a sort of a slightly pulling each other or sort of in the conversation. Maybe Lee always carefully place these elements. So like if you look at the stone on the right side, it's tilting towards the plate and the edge of the plate is raising. So to me, it feels like they're sort of a nodding head to each other or saying hello to each other, but not too close. Thank you very much for your comments. And I'd like to share a quick discussion activity ideas that I came up with this artwork in your class. So we did the first one. How do you perceive the relationship between the stone and the steel plate? And second one, you could do with your students in the class, or you could do by yourself at home. Pick two objects around you and arrange them as you like. Give it give it a title in one word. Move one of the objects to a different position and do the same. So I have a highlight marker and a post-it note here. And I would arrange this way first, and I would entitle this piece as Dominance. And I move my post-it to the sideway, put next to the marker like this, and I would call it a Friendship. So like this, you can just play around with the object around you and come up with the the term that sort of defines the relationship or you perceive between those objects. So here's a picture of Lee selecting stones in the quarry. So he always go stone picking for his exhibition locally. So wherever he has an exhibition, he select the stone locally and very carefully. So these are not random stones. He selected each single stones for his exhibition every time. And on the right side, you can see the process of installation. So not just thinking of the relationship between the steel plates and stones, he also considered the surrounding environment, such as museum architecture or the existence of the viewers. So once viewers walking around his piece, so the viewer became part of the relationship and changed the sort of dynamic between the rock and stone. And I'd like to quickly introduce these sort of a unique culture in East Asia. So there's no sort of Lee didn't talk about connection to his artwork, but I thought there's sort of some resonance with the Lee's artwork, also Marcel Duchamp's the ready-made art. So on the left side, this is an example of Gongxi or Scholar's Rock in China. This culture started in over 1,000 years ago, and the culture was imported by Korea and Japan. So it's called Suiseki in Japan, and it's called Suseok in Korea. So these are the found rocks, but carefully selected by experts. And it has to be the specific shape that sort of reminds people of the vast landscape of the mountains. Like for example, if you look at the right picture, it looks like a sort of the rock formations in the mountain or the island or waterfall. So these culture has existed in East Asia for a long time, and these sort of uniquely shaped rock appreciation and also these rocks are treated like art in those countries. And there are a lot of cultures and rich histories everywhere in the world. But that we don't see these unique cultures in mainstream history, especially in the Western history of art. So, however, a lot of contemporary artists all over the world references those unique local cultures in their artworks. So it is sometimes, you know, very interesting to look outside of the you know, general art history or Western art history, and learn about, you know, other cultures and histories, you know, of the you know, countries and areas all over the world. So next artist we're going to look at together was created is Gabriel Orozco, and this work is entitled AstroTurf Constellation, and this piece is consists of 1,188 found objects, including plastic, glass, paper, metal, and other materials. So it is similar to sort of a lease in activities of, you know, picking stones at the quarry. But the Orozco picked even smaller, tiny, tiny objects, you know, from the playing field where he practiced the boomerang in Manhattan. So these tiny objects, or, you know, the debris that he found in the playing field, were left by the athlete or the audience, or maybe sometimes, you know, the birds or some other, you know, animals. So let's take a close look at the this work. So in these close-up pictures, you may recognize, you know, the rubber bands or some sort of piece of string and tangled, you know, the thread, or the pins, you know, cigarette butts, you know, piece of a soccer ball, or the feather, and, you know, plastic bottle cap, candy wrappers, container of a lip balm, and so on. So his focus as an artist was sort of, you know, presenting the poetic, you know, encounter to this mundane object, and treat it, you know, like, you know, archaeological excavation. And he sorted out, you know, he documented everything carefully, and he sorted out, you know, based on the shapes and colors and materials. And it, you know, he turned, you know, these debris or garbage into a beautiful artwork. So this piece sort of shows the possibility that, that these, even, you know, the object, you know, normally considered a garbage, can be an art. And also the title AstroTurf Constellation sort of connotes the connection, you know, between, you know, these little objects, you know, found in the playing field to the you know, outer space. And some of the these, you know, objects are natural material, such as, you know, feathers and, you know, pebbles. And some are more artificial. But all these, you know, little elements, also ourselves as a human being, are the components of the universe. So this art is sort of you know, poetically connected these minuscule objects, and it's in relationship to ourselves and to the universe. So next artist is Zoe Leonard, and this artwork is entitled 1961. So this artwork consists of vintage suitcases. So the title 1961 is her birth year, and as the caption says, one suitcase added every year. So I think so far I counted the, you know, the number of the suitcase in this picture. There are about 50 suitcases, and it is, you know, keep growing every year. So she adds new suitcase, you know, every year to this piece. And if you think about, you know, the suitcases, it sort of connotes the sense of travel and adventure or escape, romance. And also she, you know, intentionally selected, you know, these vintage suitcases instead of pristine, you know, new suitcases, so that the, so these, you know, suitcases have scratches and scuffs and, you know, smudges on it. But she even, you know, appropriated, you know, those scratches and you know, scuffs to represent, you know, the journey of her life. And it grows, you know, every year until her death. So once, you know, when she dies, you know, it stops. So that way she could sort of present the inevitable, you know, passage of time, you know, herself, you know, aging. also the mortality of the human being through this activity and this sculpture. So she called, you know, this piece sculptural and conceptual self-portrait. So found object can be used to sort of represent, you know, someone's, you know, self-portrait instead of painting the, you know, the image of the person. So the next artist, Felix Gonzalez Torres, created the, sort of this installation with 700 pounds of candies. It is untitled and, in a parenthesis, Public Opinion. It was made in 1991. So Gonzalez Torres sort of came up with this idea of creating a sort of pile of candy as his artwork, which is a very unconventional material for art. But not just that, this work invites audience and viewers to pick, you know, one candy from the pile and take it with them, and you can, you know, eat it. So that sort of adds another element, you know, to this artwork and make it very transformative, the same way Leonard, you know, the suitcase growing every year. So Gonzalez Torres created the sort of a two different way of presenting this piece. So one way is the one we just saw, you know, piled against the corner of the room, and the other way is spread on the floor in a square form. So you can, you know, see the scale of this piece compared to the person, you know, picking the candy in the texture. And on the right side, you can see the close-up, you know, image of the candies. So when he created this piece, it was, 1991, and the Gulf War was happening. And so he created the war. And, you know, the subtitle, you know, Public Opinion, suggests that, you know, his reaction and how he questioned the public opinion, you know, has been formulated and manipulated and exploited to advance, you know, political agenda. So he chose, you know, carefully this color and the flavor of the candy to represent, you know, his disgust. And also the candy, you know, if you take a look at the picture on the right side, the shape of the candy resembles the shape of the missiles used in the war. So here's a quick discussion activity ideas for Gonzalez Torres piece. So this is for maybe, it takes a while, maybe, so that the, recommend for the you know, classroom activities or individual activities at home. So what kind of candy, color, shape, flavor, texture would you choose if you were the artist and wanted to express different emotions like happy, sad, angry, etc. with it? And then think what kind of shape you would make with the pile of candies as an installation and why. Make a drawing of the imaginary candy pile. So, you know, it is hard to get 700 pounds of candy by yourself. So instead, you can make a drawing about it. And actually making drawing is the first step of a large, you know, scale project. Make drawing in the beginning to sort of visualize the idea and also communicate the idea to the other, you know, people. Drawing doesn't have to be realistic, but just need to be sort of visualize and communicate in what you're thinking. So you can add sort of a hope you can enjoy making, you know, sort of a drawing for the imaginary candy pile project. So this artwork here has a very similar quality to Gonzalez Torres's candies. You know, it's also black and shiny. So here I'd like to do a quick activity with everyone. I share the information about this piece. I want everyone to look at this artwork for 30 seconds. And please pick one adjective to describe your impression of this work and type in the chat. So let's start now. shattered, cozy, droopy, reverie, torn, sleek, discarded, solemn, unstable, shiny. Thank you everyone for sharing your perception and observation and thoughts. This is all. Thank you very much. Again, it is so interesting to hear from everyone who has completely different point of view. Cow litter, poor cow, she died. I think that this is looks like a leather, so made from the cow skin. Thank you very much for the comment. So let's move to the next slide to see the information about this work. So the artist who created this piece is Yan Bo, and he entitled this piece Lot 20, Two Kennedy Administration Cabinet Room Chairs, made in 2013, and it is leather. So Yan Bo was originally from Vietnam, and when he was 4 years old, his family fled Vietnam due to the damage by the war. And his father built a boat and escaped from the country, and the boat was rescued by a Danish commercial ship. And the family ended up moving to Denmark. However, the Vietnam, where he lived, was damaged by war, and also the America. But his father had this idea of American dream, so that he wanted to move to America. But instead, they moved to Denmark. And actually, his father became very successful in Denmark. So the title kind of suggests that this pieces of leathers are from actually a very specific chairs used in the Kennedy the cabinet room, and this picture was taken in 1962. So Bo encountered two of these chairs at the auction by accident. And he purchased, from the auction and turned it to his artwork. So he always, carefully select the historically charged object to create his artwork. So let's go back to the picture of the sculpture. So instead of presenting the chair as is, he sort of tear apart the leather part of the chair and hang it on the wall. So by doing so, he could add extra sort of a meaning to this piece. Also, he could maybe express, his emotion, through the action of tearing up and hanging on the wall. So Bo often creates, pieces that sort of connects the personal history of his family, and also as well as the global, politics, history of the global politics. In this case, the Vietnam War, through his artwork. So here's a quick discussion activity ideas. So we did the first, half of the first one. So look at the work without any information and describe the impression in one word. After learning where the material was from and the story of the artist's family, discuss how your impression of the work changed. So you can do the second half of this activity with your students in a classroom. How might an alteration to form or shape change an object meaning? Think of one object that may symbolize your personal history as well as collective history. So this, the last activity might take time, so please allow everyone to, take some time to think about, this activity when you do with your students or by yourself. So I have this cell phone as an example to which represents my personal history and the collective history. So this cell phone is broken and the screen is shattered. So I was very reluctant to get the smartphone. I loved my flip phone for a long time. At some point, my husband convinced me to buy smartphone. He's very tech savvy, so he did the research for me to get the sort of a decently priced phone, and I got this, and I was using this as a watch during my tour at the museum. And during the tour, I was just, you know, checking the time on this and dropped it on the floor, and the screen was shattered. And make things worse, you know, that tour was being observed by my supervisor. So I have to sort of pretend nothing happened, you know, and kept going on the tour. So that's my personal memory attached to this phone. And also, as a collective history, I assume, you know, this, you know, the phone could represent the sort of you know, rapid, you know, advancement of the technology in past few decades. And these days, you know, our life is completely adjusted to live with, you know, this gadgets. And also, maybe this, you know, shattered screen, like a broken screen, could be a shared, you know, a shared experience of a lot of people, you know, who have had, you know, this type of phone, very fragile. So next artist, Leslie Hewitt, has been also creating artworks that connects, you know, public and the private histories. Riffs on 7 of 10. This is one artwork from the series of 10. So she's a photographer. However, her approach to the photography is very unique, and she sort of combines a sculptural, you know, the approach to the creation of her photography. So first, you know, she found the old magazine featuring the black and white picture of you know, a student's demonstration in Tasaka, and she placed on the wooden floor of her apartment. And also she found another small, you know, snapshot of you know, the gathering or cookout in somebody's backyard, and, you know, she placed on top of the magazine. So first, you know, she built up, you know, this magazine and photography as a three-dimensional object. So let's take a look at the installation view. So on the left side, you can see the installation view of this series. So there are five in this picture, and there are five other works on the other side of the room, other side of the room. And on the right side, you can see the close-up image of the work we just saw. So in this piece, in this picture, you can see the you know, the snapshot, you know, very well. Also, if you take a careful look on the right, you know, lower right corner of the snapshot, you can see the shadow of the you know, this photography against the in the magazine below. Let's go back. So she sort of emphasized the materiality of the photography, and sort of also she appropriated, you know, other photographers, you know, works as her works. So this is like appropriation. That's a very great example of appropriation. And also that she carefully selected, you know, the photographs that she used. One on the magazine, black and white picture, is a representation of a sort of public, you know, media representation of black people in late 70s. And the one on top, in, you know, a small amateur snapshot, represents more like you know, private, you know, lived experience of the you know, black people in the, around the same time. However, this private, you know, the you know, experience of the you know, black people are not featured in media. So by combining, you know, those two images, she could sort of create the artwork that represents both, you know, public history and the private history of the black people in 1970s and 80s. So I have one more Yambo's piece in which he actually appropriated, you know, other artist work also. So this piece is entitled We the People, and this is a detailed view of the whole artwork. And if you look at the year he made, it took 5 years to, you know, complete this piece. It is made of copper. And actually this is a replica, a life-size replica of a hand of a Statue of Liberty. And he entitled We the People. So that sort of resonates with the you know, the both fathers, you know, desire to live in America, you know, where a lot of people around the world, you know, believed, you know, there's an American dream, and it's a country of freedom. So you can see the picture of the Statue of Liberty on the left side, and on the right side you can see the other parts of the replica he produced in this project. So Bo, you know, came up with this sort of a large-scale project to create a you know, a life-size replica of the Statue of Liberty, but he didn't have money, so he had to start with the, finding the person who can afford to create this, you know, to fund this project. So he found one, you know, a collector, art collector, and she, you know, funded the entire project for him. And next, you know, he had to find a foundry who could, you know, produce, you know, these replica with the same technique, you know, used for the original Statue of Liberty. So he found a place in China and ordered to create, you know, these pieces. So maybe that's why it took so long, you know, 5 years to complete this project. And then once all the parts of the Statue of Liberty were, you know, created, the person who funded the project, you know, claimed to, you know, keep everything by herself. However, Bo opposed the idea and, you know, gave her a certain amount of the pieces, and the rest were sold to other collectors around the world, collectors and institutions around the world. So in other words, you know, these pieces are never going to be assembled as a, you know, the sort of a whole statue. So let's go back to Statue of Liberty on the left side. So this is the statue, you know, gifted from France to the U.S. In 1880 war. Incarnation of the idea of liberty. And Sebo also created a replica and also, like, you know, left it, you know, fragmentated. So by doing so, he could show how thin the actual statue is. And also by doing so, he could, you know, represent, you know, how fragile the idea of the liberty is. So probably, you know, just left it, you know, fragmented, you know, fragmentated is another way to present the fragility of the liberty, the idea of the liberty that especially his father and admired and made him, you know, wanted to move to the US. Although, you know, his family had to fled, you know, their own country because of the Vietnam War. So the next slide is actually a video created by you know, Sao Fei, and it's entitled RMB City, a Second Life City Planning by China Tracy, aka Sao Fei, made in 2007. So this video was created by you know, Sao Fei Studio and uploaded on the YouTube, and as through, you know, Sao Fei's avatar named, you know, China Tracy. So let's watch this video for 2 minutes together and talk about it later. Thank you. video quality was not very good, but here's a clear still image of the LMB City, a second life city planning by China Tracy, aka Sofei. So first, I'd like to mention that this artwork was created inside of the virtual city called Second Life. It's an online virtual world with a flea market economy. And she sort of walked with her collaborators, you know, from around the world, and created, you know, this sort of a you know, bizarre structure island inside of the virtual city. So in other words, you know, this city, this in artwork, doesn't have a physical presence. It exists only in the virtual world. So when she created this piece, so she combined a lot of historic, you know, buildings and you know, monuments and icons of China. For example, you can see the Tiananmen Square in the center. Let's go to the next slide. So these, you know, the icons and monuments are included in the Sofei's Second Life LMB City. So Oriental Tower in Shanghai, Tiananmen Square, CCTV headquarters building, Statue of Mao Zedong, Chinese flag, and also Olympic Stadium. So talked about her sort of a background, and as you know, she was a person, she was an artist, you know, who was influenced by global internet community and pop culture, such as Japanese animations and TVs and hip hop and Cantonese pop. Rather than, you know, they're being influenced by older generation of Chinese artists who are bound to, you know, nationalistic idea or restricted by politics. So instead, she sort of escaped from the, you know, the real sort of a life of a Chinese artist and created a more sort of free world in the virtual city, collaborated with international collaborators. And also, it is very interesting that the Sou, you know, selected, you know, these sort of iconic monuments and buildings, but she turned it into completely different things. So if you take a close look at the Tiananmen Square behind the bicycle wheel, it's a historically charged place, but she turned it into a swimming pool where, you know, visitors to the city can, you know, relax and socialize. And she did the same thing for other structures too. So completely ignored the meanings, in the sort of original meanings, and also the connotation of the you know, structures and monuments. And also the title RMB City sounds like a currency of China, renminbi. And that's there's a reason why she did it, because she analyzed, you know, what was happening in Chinese economy, you know, in past few decades, and figured out that, you know, the Chinese economy consists of, you know, capitalism and socialism and communism. And also this like bizarre, the, you know, cluster of the monuments and the structures represents the theatricality of the rapid urbanization, you know, happening in China in past few decades. So here's a quick discussion activity ideas. So view the video together and share what you recognize and how you interpret the video. And we're going to do the second one together here. Think which monuments or icons you would include if you created an American or any country where you live version of the virtual city. So please type in the chat, you know, if you, you know, have some sort of a specific monument or icons you would include in your virtual city in the chat. You can type in now. There's some comment about the panda in place of Chairman Mao. I mean, this is Muslim. Niagara Falls, Independence Hall. Anything else? A homeless tent, that's interesting. It's kind of representing the current time in our society. In my country, the monument to the middle of the world. Oh, that's interesting too. Thank you. So there are many sort of monuments and you know, the buildings, you know, everywhere that you could, or icons that you can include in this virtual city for yourself. The screen as a monument. University, airfield, plant community. Thank you very much for your contributions. And we can maybe put these together and create the universal version of the virtual city, like Sophie did in the Second Life. And for the class, you could also ask, how do you transform the function and the meaning of these elements? You know, this is just for fun to sort of turn, you know, historically charged or you know, something considered important into something else by yourself. So the RMB city is not just a sort of absurd, you know, construction built in Second Life. You know, so and her collaborators organized the city. So called this, you know, city as the utopia in the making. So, for example, this picture shows the dance party organized by the collaborators in RMB city. And also they organized the photo shoot and art exhibitions and also inauguration ceremony for the mayors of this city. And all the participants, you know, had to create their avatar to. And those avatars doesn't have to look like, you know, you or be exact, you know, characteristic as you, but instead you can be, you know, any kind of person you want to be. And you can put any outfit you want to. So some of the you know, the artists in the, you know, Second Life, you know, design the you know, uniquely designed, you know, the clothes and sell it to other people, or other people can buy, you know, these, you know, clothes from other people. So that's the unique aspect of the Second Life, where you can buy and sell stuff, and also you can exchange, you know, the money currency used in the Second Life to the physical, you know, the currency that we use in our world. So this idea of sort of building utopia recurs, has been recurring in art and literature. And when I, you know, learned about, you know, Sophie's Second Life, RMB City, that reminded me of this old tale in China called The Peach Blossom Spring. So this tale's story goes, the fisherman, you know, he's right here, got lost while he was walking, and he ended up in this sort of a hidden community somewhere far away from where he lived. And these people in this village were living in, you know, harmony with nature and very peacefully, and they treated him very nicely. You know, how did they end up here? And the villagers told him that their ancestors escaped from the civil unrest or the war and sort of created this isolated community. And since then, generation after generation, they are living in this little village, a little community, you know, peacefully. And also they told the fishermen not to tell anyone about this village. However, once, you know, the fisherman left the village and went back to, you know, his home, he brought, you know, his friends and tried to find this village again, but they couldn't find the village again. And this, you know, tale was written in the year 421, and that time was also, you know, the China or the dynasty at that time was going through the war. So quickly, I'd like to introduce other examples of artworks that sort of touches the idea of a utopia. So here's the French painter Robert Delaunay, entitled Eiffel Tower, made in 1911. So he painted the very iconic structure in Paris, in Eiffel Tower, and he depicted almost like a religious painting, religious figure in the painting. Placed the tower in the center and exaggerated, scale. So this tower is a representation of a modernization of France. Also, this is a representation of advanced technology in the early 20th century. So from this painting, you can sense the sort of optimism for the future with the technology and science. And on the other hand, Korean artist Lee Bo created this piece entitled Drifting Ashen, Flake Opaque in 2008. And this sort of sculpture looks like a dystopian, post-apocalyptic, structure. And her sort of her focus was, failure, after the attempt to create a perfect society, or achieving to the utopia through the advanced technology, but the most of the time somehow human being ends up failure, and so that's the theme of the artwork. And maybe her upbringing in Korea under the political military dictatorship, and also watching a lot of movies might have influenced her the view of the world. So to discuss this piece, you can use the sets of opposing words I put on the upper right corner here, such as utopia, dystopia, beautiful, grotesque, future, past, real, imagined, monuments, ruins, humans, technologies, individual, collective. So yeah, please use these words to discuss this piece in the class, if you wish. And a quick discussion activity ideas. So what is a utopia? Research the definition and other examples of utopias in art, architecture, film, literature, and online gaming. Also think what kind of activities you would organize in your utopian city. Also think about top five priority roles that you would set for the community. So you can do with the individually, or you can do with the small groups. And the conclusion of today's seminar. So these are the sort of three takeaways from this seminar. Art has infinite possibilities of how it is created and how it is interpreted. An object has had the potential to hold many different meanings and tell a variety of stories. It could also connect different times and spaces. Every once in a while, it is worth taking a moment and contemplating an artwork, object, or image, and then exchanging thoughts with others. These activities reveal the complexity and diversity of this world. So as I started this webinar with the quotation by Ruth Asawad, I'd like to end it with the another quotation by the same artist. Art is for everyone. It is not something that you should have to go to the museum in order to see and enjoy. And I assume a lot of people are stuck at home due to the COVID pandemic. And also the access to the museums are limited these days. So instead, I recommend everyone to use your imagination and creativity and things around you to enjoy art at home. Thank you again for joining today's webinar, and thank you for your comments in the chat during the activity. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you so much, Shinsuke. So if anybody has questions, feel free to put them in the Q&A, and we can stay on a few minutes after this session to answer any questions. But in the meantime, I really want to thank you, Shinsuke, for demystifying a very difficult subject in contemporary art, which is found objects and images, and just providing so many hopeful possibilities for how these collections can really suggest meaning I want to remind everybody that we have two more sessions coming up in this series, and I put the link in the chat if you'd like to register. Next Tuesday, we have a session on materials and process, and next Wednesday, we have one on installation. And again, we'll be sending out a link to this recording if you'd like to come back to Shinsuke's wonderful discussion and activity ideas at a later point. We'll also be following up with a brief survey. If you have time, please let us know, because we're continuing to develop virtual offerings for educators, and we'd love to hear your feedback. But otherwise, have a great afternoon and a wonderful rest of the week.
Thank you, everyone.